Okay, in this segment, we're going to introduce the idea of aggregate supply. And here's where things are going to start to look different than what we've seen in our normal markets for cereal or milk or whatever it is else out there. So in particular, what's going to happen here is that we are going to have two simultaneous supply curves in the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model. And what we're going to talk about first is the long run aggregate. Aggregate supply curve. And because that's a mouthful to write and a mouthful to say, I'm going to often abbreviate it LRAS here. And the idea of long-run aggregate supply is to bring in some of those insights of the classical economists, and that's the idea that supply, or at least in the long run, supply is constrained by the factors of production. So how many workers we have, what their skill levels are, what our natural resources are, what our level of technology is, that kind of stuff. So all that stuff about long-run economic growth is basically a question of long-run aggregate supply. So in the Mankiw textbook, say for instance, chapter 12 is all about long-run aggregate supply. And remember that we think that in the long run, the classical dichotomy holds. And the classical dichotomy and the associated idea of monetary neutrality holds in the long run. And the basic idea here is that nominal variables are just labels that we put on things. They're just names. And that nominal variables don't influence real variables. So when we put a new price on something, when the price goes up or the price goes down, that's like we're just putting a new label on something. It's like we decide to call giraffes schmooze or something like that. And, you know, we can do that if we want, but that's not going to change what a giraffe really is or how many giraffes we have. So the idea here is that if this is the amount of real GDP that is supplied at this price level, well, a lower price level is just changing the label, and we don't think in the long run that will actually damage society's factors of production. You know, if all the prices go down in the economy, that doesn't suddenly cause people to lose their skills or cause the labor force to die off or cause acres of land to fall into the sea or anything like that. So in the long run, we think that the amount the economy can produce is not responsive to the price level. So another way of putting this is the long-run aggregate supply curve, we think, is totally vertical. In terms of shifts, it probably slowly shifts out over time as, say, for instance, we have technological growth. That would cause the curve to shift out, because we could expand our economy's productive capacity, how much GDP we could produce. We also tend to have population and labor force growth. And finally, we may have some accumulation of capital. Or hopefully not, but hopefully decrease of natural resources, which would shift us back the other way. So it sort of shifts outwards, and sort of the estimates here are for the U.S. economy, say for instance, it might be shifting outwards by like 2.5% per year. In many of the analyses we'll do, we're going to basically ignore the fact that it shifts outward a little bit over the years. Because a lot of times when we're using the aggregate demand, aggregate supply model, we're really interested in issues of what's happening in the short run, what's happening with a business cycle. And the idea that sort of we have this long-run slow growth of our potential output by 2.5% per year is sort of not telling us a whole bunch about what's happening with business cycles in the short run. That actually brings to mind here. This sometimes is also called potential GDP. So long-run aggregate supply is sometimes called potential GDP. It's also, especially among older economists, called full employment GDP. So those are all synonyms for long-run aggregate supply. I really don't sort of like either of them. Potential GDP, well, we'll see later that the economy can sometimes perform beyond its potential. So really it should be potentially long-run sustainable GDP, which would be pretty darn cumbersome. And the idea of full employment GDP sort of gets to the idea of, well, do we actually know what full employment is? We know full employment isn't 0% unemployment, because that never happens. So that sort of gets us back into thinking about Nehru and so on and so forth. This is sometimes called the natural rate of output, in parallel with the natural rate of unemployment. So let me go ahead and talk about that for a second. The idea is, here's sort of the normal level of production the economy usually produces. So this is what the economy produces. When not in either a boom or a bust, when it's sort of at a Goldilocks moment, it's neither running really hot nor really cold. If GDP is less than long-run aggregate supply, we're having a bust. If GDP is temporarily running above long-run aggregate supply, then we're in a boom. And where we are with GDP relative to long-run aggregate supply tells us where we are with unemployment relative to the natural rate. In particular, if we're producing less output than we normally do, then unemployment is going to be above the natural rate of unemployment, or the Nehru. If we're having exceptionally high output, then we're going to need lots and lots of workers to do that. And in this case, if we're in a boom over here, unemployment is below the Nehru. So knowing something about GDP relative to our normal level of output tells us something about unemployment relative to its natural rate, or its Nehru. Usually, we'll be adding a short-run aggregate supply curve to our diagrams, but we can get some mileage out of just the aggregate demand curve and the long-run aggregate supply curve. And in particular, this is going to explain the long-run evolution of GDP, real GDP, and prices. So, in particular, if we start here, and remember we can think about aggregate demand as being linked to this quantity equation for money, what happens if long-run aggregate supply grows, but the money supply doesn't change? If long-run aggregate supply grows and the money supply doesn't change, then we go from long-run aggregate supply 1 to long-run aggregate supply 2, and we go from price level 1 to price level 2. So before, when we talked about the quantity equation of money, we talked about, well, what happens with prices depends on the movement or the growth rate of the money supply relative to real GDP. This is another way of understanding that same idea. So if we have real GDP in the form of long-run aggregate supply grow, without the money supply growing, we're going to get deflation. So that's one way of looking at it. Now, the money supply does grow over time. Even in a gold standard economy, new gold supplies are discovered. If it grows by a little bit, call this 1.5, then we'll have less deflation than we otherwise would. If it grows by a larger amount here, we'll challenge my artistic skills to get this right. If it grows out to something like this, then we could have a stable level of prices. So notice here, this is the distance long-run aggregate supply shifted out. If aggregate demand shifts out by the same amount here, then prices are stable. What we tend to observe in most economies is gradual inflation over time. So what that's telling us is that the aggregate demand curve is shifting outwards over time, and it's shifting outwards by more than long-run aggregate supply is, so we in fact get an increase in the price level.